Welcome back to the final day of our urban retreat. And we've been looking at the Metta bhavana practice stage by stage. And we've reached looking at the final stage of the Metta bhavana, the fifth stage, which we've actually been doing over 2 days. So yesterday we looked at that aspect, which is about bringing everyone in the practice so far together and trying to have a sense of metta towards them equally. Equalising out our sense of well-wishing. And then today we're going to look at the final aspect of the whole practice, which is expanding outwards to include more and more people, and also, in a way, more and more life. It doesn't just have to be human beings. Our sense of well-wishing can include everything that lives, everything that feels, if we want that. So I'm going to make three suggestions for how we might engage in this part of the practice, the expanding out towards others. So the first one is to expand out geographically, you could say. So in a way, this is what we've been doing through the lead meditations this week, of just thinking of everyone in the practice so far, and then maybe thinking of everyone in the house where we are, in the street where we are, in the town where we are, in the country where we are, and so on. So just gradually expanding outwards, radiating outwards in that kind of way, trying to bring more people into our awareness. And we might even do that by kind of taking our awareness to the north, to the south, to the east and to the west and so on. Whatever helps us expand outwards in that kind of way. So that's one suggestion, to expand outwards geographically, as it were. And then a second suggestion is to think of people in particular situations or particular life situations, you could say. So while you're meditating, doing the fifth stage of the Metta Bhavana, you just consider that right now as you're meditating, there are people being born, there are people dying, there are young, there are old, there are people in health, there are people in sickness. There are people for whom the day is just beginning. There are people on the other side of the world for whom the day is just ending, and so on. So just trying to think of different life situations and using that as a way of connecting with people and connecting with our common humanity. So that's the second thing that you could try, or approach you could try to this stage of the practice. And then the third suggestion is to think of what you could call representative examples. So particularly if you find the first two things I've suggested a bit abstract, so if you find that you're expanding outwards geographically and it just gets a bit abstract and you lose your connection with people, you can do what you could call thinking of a representative example. So what this means is, say you're trying to send your metta out across New Zealand, which is on the other side of the world from where we are right now, and it just gets a bit abstract, it's a bit far away and a bit hard to connect with, you think of a representative example. You think of someone that you do know in New Zealand, someone specific and real that you can connect with a bit more easily. And then you think of their family, or you maybe think of the people they work with, or the people that live in their town, and so on. So you start with someone that you know as a way in, as a way to connect, as a way to be able to expand out and bring more people and places and situations into your awareness. Yeah. So those are just three suggestions for engaging with this part of the practice. And as with everything else, the idea is to keep it fresh, to try and keep it alive, to try different things over time, and just to see what works for you. And probably different things will work at different times. Yeah, so just have that kind of fresh and creative, experimental approach to the practice in that kind of way. At the same time, you know, trying to keep it simple, not letting it get over complicated. The idea is just to do whatever helps you connect, whatever helps you hold more people in awareness and wish them well. Yeah. So the final thing I want to do is just look at three things that can happen, particularly at this stage of the practice, and ways that we might respond to them. Yeah. So the first one is distraction. Yeah. So this might happen at any time during the Metta Bhavana practice. Our minds goes off into distraction. But maybe it's particularly liable to happen here, because we're broadening out our awareness, we're including more and more people and more situations. So in a way, there's more for our mind to hook up onto. There's more possibility of us just kind of getting interested in something and it takes us off into a distraction. So in a way, I'm just mentioning that so we watch out for it and not worry about it too much. And if it happens, just not giving ourselves a hard time. It happens to all meditators. We all get distracted sometime, but we can just watch out for that. And as soon as we notice it, bring ourselves back to the meditation and the kind of expanding out to include others. Yeah. And then a second thing that might happen is that we do this stage of the practice, but it just feels a bit nice or a bit sugary or a bit sentimental. It doesn't feel kind of real or deep enough to us. Yeah. And again, this can just happen. It's part of the process of meditating. And in a way, not to worry about it too much. As long as we're trying to engage with the practice, as long as we're doing our best to be aware and be authentic, in time the practice will go deeper. In time the practice will be kind of real and engaged, as it were. But that just takes time. It's a process. And it's not always going to go deep straight away. But as long as we're making an effort, as long as we're being creative and engaged with the practice, that's fine. That's all we need to do. That's all we need to worry about, as it were. So, yeah, in a way, notice if that's happening, but don't get over concerned about it. Just keep engaging with the practice as best you can. And then the third thing to mention is the possibility of getting overwhelmed by what's going on in the world, and particularly by suffering and difficulty that people are confronted with in the world. And again, that can sometimes happen, particularly at this stage in the practice, because we're expanding outwards, we're thinking of people across the world, and well, yes, that does include the fact that there is a lot of suffering in the world. Yeah. So if this happens to you and you're finding that difficult and you're finding a sense of overwhelm, there's a few things that you can do that might be helpful. So the first one is just to tell yourself that the fact this is happening to you is in a way a sign of success. Yeah, it's not a sign of failure. The fact is that you're being aware of people and you're feeling overwhelmed shows that you care. It shows that you're feeling something. So in a way, that's a sign of success. That's a sign that underneath that overwhelm, there's a positive intention. There's a positive wish for those people. So that can just be a helpful thing to remind yourself of and tell yourself of as a way of responding to that overwhelm. A second thing you can do is just also be aware that you're doing something positive. You're not ignoring that suffering. You're not ignoring the problems in the world. You're at least responding in some way. At least you're trying to be aware of it. At least you're doing something rather than being passive. So again, that's just a positive thing to remind yourself, which can be helpful. Yeah. And by doing the practice, you're not going to take away all that suffering, of course, but at least you're doing something. You're doing something that is possible for you to do, and you're sowing seeds in your heart, which will mean as you go back out into the world, you're more likely to be able to respond to that world with some positivity and kindness and compassion and so on. So you're doing something and you're doing what you can. And that's a good thing and really worth reminding yourself about. And then lastly, a last possible response to this sense of overwhelm is just to make sure that your approach to the practice is balanced. Yeah. So yes, you may be aware of suffering and difficulty in the world, but it's good to balance that out with awareness that there are also people that are working to alleviate suffering. There are also people that do amazing things. Act with amazing compassion, act with amazing generosity, make great sacrifices, as it were. So don't let your awareness be one-sided, either one way or the other. Yes, do take into awareness suffering and difficulty that people face, but also bring into awareness the amazing things that people do to respond to that, to try and help alleviate that. And that will balance out your practice of the Metta Bhavana. So yeah, you can try those things and see whether they help you. So that's basically the end of our teaching on the urban retreat. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you found it interesting and useful and even inspiring, and that you feel inspired to really engage with this practice of the Metta Bhavana. It's a very profound and far-reaching deep practice. It can really change you. It can really change your life. And I hope that you feel inspired to carry on meditating and carrying on trying to cultivate awareness and loving kindness to more and more people. And yeah, I really wish you luck with your practice.